I was working as a Middle East intelligence analyst at NSA, the National Security Agency, and my supervisor informed me several days before the attack began that the blank will hit the fan on Saturday. I learned that they were caught by surprise, because I was monitoring live communication from the battlefront on the first day of the attack. And I caught an Israeli soldier on the Barlev line, that's a string of fortifications along the Suez Canal. He telephoned to his mother, and I'm listening to the conversation. They had no idea that somebody on the other side of the planet was listening to their conversation. I can't give the details of the conversation because my book has been authorized by the Pentagon to publish, but there are certain sections that I was required to remove. And that conversation was one of the sections that I was required to remove. And so I can't give you details about that, but I can tell you that I was surprised that those soldiers were surprised. It bothered me from the outset, from the very outset, when I realized that this Israeli soldier and his buddies were caught by surprise. It troubled me. And I wasn't ignited on investigating until I stumbled upon a New York Times article. I believe it was the 12th of September, 1975, in which the Pike Commission was investigating different failures of the intelligence community. They were concentrating on budget, if taxpayers' money was well spent. One of the items was the testimony of a Dr. Ray Klein, who testified before the Congressional Investigation Committee, and he said all of the intelligence agencies of the United States were caught by surprise. How could that be? We knew, we in G6, the section of NSA that targets the Middle East, we knew. How could it be that the head of the intelligence agencies testified before Congress under oath that they didn't know? That's what ignited me to begin seriously investigating. What's the story here? Something smells. Well, I started picking up little details here and there, but when General Eli Zeira, who is the head of Israeli military intelligence, was 90 years old, and he was still alive, and he's still alive today at 95, this was 5 years ago, I said, he's not going to live forever. If I want to get the real story, I have to give him a buzz and suggest to him that I have something that would be of interest to him to hear. He invited me to his home twice, and he confided in me that he received an intelligence assessment from his American friends that the Arabs were not going to attack. I'm sitting across the kitchen table from him, and I tell him, how could that be? I was hardly a sergeant, not even a sergeant, very low rank. Here he is, sitting across the table from me, a general, the head of Israeli military intelligence. He didn't know But I did know. How could that be?
It's a pleasure to be here. It's a little bit intimidating because I'm not a well-known author. I'm not a college lecturer. I don't have PhDs after my name. This book that I wrote out of passion, passion for the truth. And I appreciate the folks at the Allen City Public Library for giving me a forum to present the truth that's been hidden for a half a century. And I'd like to begin by just showing this message that I received on my way to Allen City from an old friend who's sitting here in the audience, Terry, who mentions this problem that Israel is facing today, the Hamas attack of October 7th. 50 years almost to the day of the intelligence failure of the Yom Kippur War on October 6th, 1973. Because this is on everyone's mind. And by the end of the talk, if I don't make the connection between October 6th and October 7th, you'll make it yourselves. So let's begin. The story begins with a typical American boy from a typical American town back in the 1960s. This song typifies the thing that was most on our minds: how to stay out of being drafted and sent to Vietnam. Back in the early 70s, the United States Army was having a problem finding enough warm bodies to send overseas. And so the lottery was instituted, the draft lottery. The only lottery that I ever won, quote unquote, quotes intended. My number came up, I knew I would be drafted. And instead of just allowing Uncle Sam to draft me, you would take a battery of tests pre-enlistment to see what you were qualified to do and try and find a job in the service that would keep you far away from the jungles of Vietnam. You didn't want to run away to Canada or Europe, although I knew people who did that. But I wouldn't do that. I was too patriotic. My dad served during World War II, and I would serve too. But what could I do to stay out of the jungles in Vietnam? Well, you see this, you can see here this 2A. When you were a student, you had 2S, a student deferment that kept you out of the Army. 2A was an occupational deferment because after college, I was teaching, and so I had a good deferment. The 2A was a very strong deferment, particularly where I was teaching. It was in a low socioeconomic area. And so I was pretty safe until the lottery came around and I knew I was going. So my dad served, and I would serve. That's my dad during World War II. And If you look at the title of my book, it has a subtitle. It says, A Memoir of Military Antisemitism. And I told the publisher, why not also say a memoir of military anti and pro-Semitism? Because here's an example of where the United States Army, where my dad's religion was given here, you can see the H. H stood for Hebrew, meaning he was Jewish. But when he was sent to fight the Germans in Europe, he was given an alternative. Now I don't see the, there it is. An alternative dog tag with his blood type O and P for Protestant in case he fell captive to the Germans. So there's an example of where the army took care of their Jewish soldiers. And I experienced that as well. I experienced anti-Semitism and pro-Semitism. So I asked the publisher, why not put a memoir of military anti and pro-Semitism? And the publisher said, Bruce, pro-Semitism doesn't sell books. So that's why it says anti. Okay, these are some of the correspondence that someone that was tapped on the shoulder would get from the Selective Service at the time. And you can see this letter and this letter where you can appeal. And this was from my employer at the Brentwood School District where I taught, saying what a wonderful teacher I am and how I'm essential. But Uncle Sam wasn't so interested and I needed to go. And so I took a battery of tests, and one of them was what's called the ALAT test, the Army Language Aptitude Test. And I aced it. 62 questions, I got 62 right. And they said, you can have your language of choice. What would you like? Chinese, Cambodian, Laotian, Vietnamese, or Arabic? I chose Arabic. And I would enlist and become part of the Army Security Agency. These are the military intelligence. And so I enlisted for 4 years, and here's your order to appear for the physical. And it began the whole process of being drafted into the US Army. This is basic training at Fort Dix, where my dad went through basic training when it was called Camp Dix back during World War II. And then after basic training, off to Dilliwick. In the US Army, they have their own language and it's acronyms, like Dilliwick, for instance, Defense Language Institute West Coast. Everyone called it Dilliwick. And it lasted for about 10 years, but I won't bore you with the history of Dilliwick and its eventual end. But these were the barracks. These were temporary barracks built during World War II, but we used them in 1971 and 72 when I was there. And I visited them in the 1990s and they're still in use even in the 1990s. I don't know if they're still in use today, but they were then. And this is, you know, orders and assignments and things. I don't want to bore you with them too. In the language school, the classes were attended by 10 students maximum. This was a language learning process that was known to be the most efficient language learning method, where the maximum number of students in the class would be 10. And among the 10 students, we had a lieutenant colonel who would eventually be assigned to Saudi Arabia as a tank instructor. And this fellow here is Merwan. Each of us was given an Arabic name. And his name actually is Larry Merwin. So the teacher gave him the name Merwan. He was the best linguist in the class. And the reason that I'm pointing him out is because he grew up in the mountains in Colorado, and his love for languages brought him to want to immerse himself in Spanish. And to do that, he took a trip to Mexico. And his money was running out. So he found out about a program in Cuba where you work half a day on a commune and you study Spanish language half a day. And he went into the Cuban embassy in Mexico City to get some information on this program. Why is this relevant to my story about the Yom Kippur War? During his BI, here's another acronym, background investigation, for security reasons, before you get your security clearance, you go through a BI. He was asked if he ever had any contact with any communist officials. Of course, he remembered that he walked into the Cuban embassy in Mexico City, but he walked out. He had a brochure, and he never went to Cuba. He returned home. But he answered the question, no. And they caught him in a lie. Somehow they knew that he walked into the Cuban embassy in Mexico City, and they caught him in a lie. And he didn't get his security clearance. So when we were sent to Goodfellow Air Force Base after we graduated from Dilliwick. There's my diploma. And these are my orders to go to Goodfellow Air Force Base. I believe you can see that. I think it's over there someplace. Goodfellow Air Force Base for security training. Goodfellow's in Texas. My first Texas experience, San Angelo, Texas. This was Goodfellow Air Force Base. Security was very, very serious, as you can see. No, I didn't take the picture. And after security training at Goodfellow, we were sent to our permanent duty station. And Larry Merwan was sent to Fort Huachuca rather than being sent to Cushy NSA. There were three of us who were sent to NSA. NSA at the time, and that's what it looked like at the time, was the largest of America's big intelligence agencies, much bigger than the CIA. I believe it was about twice as big as the CIA. But back then, no one heard of NSA. And we would joke, NSA stands for no such agency. You can see its motto down below, in God we trust, we monitor all others. They had a sense of humor. And this was my assignment to NSA. There I am. While at NSA, everyone gets a very, very specific job to do. And you don't know what the analyst sitting next to you is doing. You don't know his job unless it somehow concerns you. There's a golden rule in intelligence that you can't even inquire what your neighbor does or anyone else does unless you have the need to know. And so I didn't know what other people did, and I had a very, very specific job that I can share with you now, even though you don't have a need to know. I was mapping out Israeli overflights of southern Lebanon and Syria, because I could just Arabic, and the coordinates were given in Arabic numerals. And so I would plot out Israeli overflights of Syria and Lebanon. Very, very specific job. Usually took maybe 20 minutes to do, but you were there at your desk for 9 hours. The hardest part of the job was looking busy for the remainder of the time that you were there. So one of the things that I did was to work in cryptology. And I had some success in breaking some codes of the Syrians. And another thing that I did was to learn what was called a collateral language, namely special Arabic. What's special Arabic? Hebrew. Back in the 1960s, it wasn't nice to spy on your friends. So linguists that spied on Israel, when I say spy, it's kind of a cute way of saying collecting information. You weren't allowed to say that you were a Hebrew linguist. Instead, you were instructed to say special Arabic. But by the 1970s, when I was working there, I got there in 1972, you could already say Hebrew. But you couldn't say that you worked as an intelligence analyst at NSA as a Hebrew linguist. You could say one or the other, but not both in the same breath. Those were our instructions, to keep a low profile. This man, the hippie in the middle, became my roommate, because when I began learning Hebrew, he was the head of the Hebrew department at NSA. And the people at the Pentagon who reviewed my book to give me permission to publish it forbade me to give his name, because he's a federal employee, or was a federal employee at the time. I assume he's retired now. But he was a super linguist, a genius, a linguistic genius. He knew several languages, most European languages, and in addition, he knew Chinese, and he was the head of the Hebrew department. And he was looking for a roommate. And at the time, I thought, wow, what could be the best roommate to have if I'm learning Hebrew than the head of the Hebrew department? And he became my roommate. And I just really appreciated the guy. He's there in this picture. Whoops, let's go back. I pressed the wrong thing. He's there in this picture next to this pretty blonde girl. That's my sister. And they were seeing each other for a while. I mean, he became almost like family. This is an example of the things that the Pentagon pre-publication review office required that I redact. I took a deep breath when I was finished with the first draft of my manuscript for this book. I took a deep breath and I sent it to the Pentagon to review it so I can get their approval. And I'm proud to say that I got their approval, not once, but twice. And I'll explain to you why. After they reviewed it, and it was a 4-month review, because they send the manuscript out to all of the major intelligence agencies for them to review it and come back to the Pentagon with their conclusions. So you have to redact what they require you to redact. And I'll tell you what this is about, even though I won't disclose what's behind the blackout. That's number one. Number two is that you can't add one word of additional content. Those are the two requirements that they make. And they were very professional and very supportive, because I'm sending them a document that basically is indicting them. And they were very supportive. I felt like I was walking into a lion's den. And the head of the review, the coordinator, was a woman with a Jewish name, but she wasn't Jewish. And I can't give you her name, but you can think of the most Jewish sounding name, and that was her name. But she wasn't Jewish, she was German, of German extraction. She was so supportive that they asked the writer to write a review of the review process. And I said, I felt like I was walking into the lion's den like Daniel, and this lady was like an angel from heaven who put my mind at ease, because I was, as you can imagine, very nervous. And I got a reply to my review of their review from the head of the office, who said, we never got such a glowing review of our review. Thank you. So good people in the Pentagon. However, after I got their approval, three things happened. Number one, a protocol was released from the IDF, the Israel Defense Forces archives, that spoke to something that was unbelievable that happened to me that inspired me to write this book. That was number one. Let me tell you what that was. Before I even began writing the book, the head of Israeli military intelligence had just turned 90 years old. And I thought to myself that I need to speak to this man, because what happened on the first day of the Yom Kippur War was an epiphany in which I came to the conclusion that, oh my God, I'm wearing the wrong uniform. What happened? I said that I was studying Hebrew, and at that moment in October of 1973, I could gist both Arabic and Hebrew. And on the first day of the Yom Kippur War, which we knew days in advance, Syria and Egypt were going to attack Israel. I knew it several days in advance. Not only did I know it, but I knew it what was called aval, which meant there was no doubt that Syria and Egypt were going to attack Israel. We knew it days in advance, and we knew on what day it was going to happen, the 6th of October, Saturday, Yom Kippur. Those of you who know Jewish religion, you know that Saturday is the Sabbath, Shabbat. So it was Yom Kippur and Shabbat fell on the same day. Similar to what happened a month ago on October 7th. It was a high holiday, the last day of Sukkot, that fell on a Sabbath. Same thing 50 years ago. So we knew days in advance, and we knew for a certainty, and we knew on what day the attack would begin. We knew all this. And on the first day of the war, because I could gist Arabic and Hebrew, I was given an assignment to monitor live communication from the battlefront, Hebrew and Arabic, and to record any communication that had military content. That was my job. And on that day, I picked up an Israeli soldier who calls his mother. And this was the conversation that's blacked out. And believe me, it's nothing terribly intriguing. It was a very mundane conversation. Why they required, the Pentagon required that I black it out is beyond me. But believe me, it's nothing terribly intriguing except that this soldier and his buddies didn't know that the attack was coming in advance. They were totally surprised. And it bothered me. Years afterwards, this bothered me. How could it be that we knew, and the Israeli on the front line, on the Barlev line, this is the string of fortifications on the Suez Canal, that soldier didn't know? How could that be? It bothered me. My assumption was, giving the benefit of the doubt, was that somehow we didn't get the information to the Israelis on time. But I was still bothered by this, and I had to meet the head of Israeli military intelligence, General Eli Zeira, and he invited me to his home in Sahala, North Tel Aviv. And he invited me to his home twice, 5 years ago. He today is 95. Kissinger, who just passed away yesterday at 100. But 5 years ago, Eli Zeira was about 90 years old, and I just had to tell him my story and had to pick his brain. And I said, you're sitting across your kitchen table from someone who is a specialist fourth class. That was my rank, spec four. You were the general and the head of Israeli military intelligence. You didn't know. And I was hardly a sergeant, not even a sergeant. And I knew, as I told you, days in advance for certainty, and knew on what day the attack was going to begin. I said, you wrote in your memoirs that foreign service, intelligence service, informed you that the Arabs were not going to attack days before the attack began. I asked him, with those intelligence services, the Americans, and he closed his eyes and closed his mouth tight and shook his head in the affirmative. He was troubled, and he shared that with me in that way. It couldn't have been more pronounced. I was so impressed by this, it so hurt me to hear this admission. And I said, how could it be that you didn't know and that you relied on these American intelligence assessments that were untrue? But we knew. I believe he didn't believe me that I knew. And when I wrote the book, when I began writing the book, a publisher said, do you have corroboration? And I said, yes, I have corroboration. I told my sister and I told my girlfriend. He said, no, that's not good. I said, well, I took a polygraph test in 1993. The Israeli daily newspaper Ma'ariv heard my story that we knew in advance. And they said, this is explosive that you knew in advance. This is explosive. We have to send you to a polygraph test to test, to make sure that you're telling the truth. And I have the results of that polygraph test. And I believe it might be, no. It'll come up, I'll get it later. I have the results of the polygraph test. That I am speaking the truth about two things. One, that we knew in advance, not just me, but my whole department knew in advance. And number two, there are rooms that I discovered in NSA that are off limits to me because I was a Jew. How did I find out about this? The same hippie, head of the Hebrew department, at a social event, he got drunk, and we were talking shop, out of shop, which is a big no-no, and he confided in me that there are rooms in NSA, and he poked me with his finger hard, that you can't get into because you're a Jew. And the polygraph test asked me about this as well. And it's confirmed not just by the polygraph test and not just from me, but John Loftus. He's an author and an investigator. He wrote a book called The Secret War Against the Jews. And he says, not only are there rooms in NSA that are off limits to you because you were a Jew, but they work against Israel and they are interagency. You'll find them in other agencies. And They are called the Jew Room. It's their name, but it's a misnomer. He says, number one, because Jews are not allowed to know that they exist. Not only are they not allowed entry into them, and number two, it's not one room. It's a series of rooms. And I wrote a letter in 1993 to the chief of security of NSA, asking him if the policy of maintaining Jew-free rooms in NSA still exists, because it did exist in 73 and 74. And I wrote two letters, one in 93 and 94, to the chief of security of NSA asking, does the policy of maintaining Jew-free rooms in NSA still exist today? What was his answer? No answer. No answer is an answer. And John Loftus, in his book that was published in 96, said that even in the 90s, the Jew Room still existed. Now, I want to know, does it exist today? And I asked John Loftus, your contacts, your informers, can you ask them if the Jew Room exists today? And he said, according to them, and he used plural, it was disbanded. And as a good American, I asked my congressman, Congressman Doug LaMalfa of the 1st Congressional District of California, where my son has residence and I use his residence as mine, even though I live in Israel. Can you find out if the Jew Room still exists today? And his answer from his sources, whatever they are, said the Jew Room no longer exists, which is an admission that it did exist at one time. Now the question is, I just said I live in Israel and I have residence in California, but I'm from Missouri on this one. Show me, when was it disbanded? Prove that it doesn't exist today. Now we get back to October 7th. And what happened on October 6th, 50 years ago, where American intelligence forwarded an intelligence assessment that was a false assessment to the head of Israeli military intelligence. And General Eli Zeira relied on the American intelligence assessment over his own, because there were many indications that an attack was imminent, that Israel's Aman, which is also a Rashi Tevot, an acronym in Hebrew, which is military intelligence, had many indications that an attack was imminent. But the head of Israeli military intelligence, General Eli Zeira, preferred to rely on the American intelligence assessment that he got. I asked General Zeira, you were duped. And he said, no. Those American generals that he was in touch with loved Israel, and they would not have duped him. So I said, if that's the case, then they themselves were duped. And he agreed. But what can you do? It's too late. In the Yom Kippur War, which lasted 3 weeks, over 2,600 Israeli soldiers were killed. in a three-week period, the majority on the first days of the war, when Israel was caught with her pants down. What could be worse? It was so traumatic for Israel. There was hardly anyone in Israel that didn't know someone or know someone who knew someone who was either killed or wounded in that war. What could be worse? Nothing could be worse than October 6th until October 7th, when Hamas came across the border. And it wasn't 3 weeks, it was a few hours. 1,300 Israeli, not military, mostly civilians, were mercifully slaughtered in the most horrific ways. I don't know how many of you have seen any real videos of what went on, but it was horrific. And it was more traumatic than what happened 50 years ago, as bad as it was. Okay, let me flip through these other things. This is me when I was now assigned during the Yom Kippur War. We were assigned to the 82nd Airborne. We were going to be dropped into Egypt with the 82nd Airborne because we knew some Arabic, and I was still an Arabic linguist for them. And you can see it's a repeat of what my father had. He had the H for Hebrew and then a P for Protestant when he was sent into battle. They gave me, for my Jewish dog tag, they gave me a Protestant in case a Jewish soldier fell into the Arab hands at that time. This is a letter from Moshe Dayan. Toward the end of the war, the Yom Kippur War, I had a cute idea. I made a sling, not a slingshot, but a sling, like David. And I made this sling, and I thought I'd have some fun. I sent it to Moshe Dayan. Now, anybody doesn't know who Moshe Dayan is? You all know who Moshe Dayan is. That's amazing. Because younger people today don't necessarily know who Moshe Dayan is, so you are all educated. I sent this sling to Moshe Dayan, and I wrote him in Hebrew, and I said, once before, in Israeli military history, a weapon like this came in handy. You know, of course, referring to David and Goliath. And I thought I'd have some fun. I said, the holy book mentions that David hit Goliath between the eyes, but really he hit him between the legs. But it's not polite to mention in a holy book. I said, I wish you the same luck with Sadat. You know, a cute thing. So that was a letter I sent to him, and I got a letter back from Moshe Dayan. And I got a letter back from his secretary in English. Can you see what it says? I have been asked to acknowledge with thanks the receipt of the eye patch. Okay, while I was working as an Arabic linguist, my immediate supervisor was an anti-Semite. I'm going back a little bit. And he wrote a terrible eval on me because I was his local Jew boy punching bag. And it upset middle management in NSA. And because of his anti-Semitism, his Jew hatred, middle management again came to my rescue. And a Air Force top sergeant, and you see his name is blocked out. The Pentagon required that I block out his name. And I said, why? I want to celebrate him. He was my hero. he was a serious Christian, and he saw that my Arabic supervisor was giving me a bad eval that was not deserved. And so he came to my rescue by giving me this eval, which superseded the bad one and replaced it. So I said, I want to celebrate him, but I can't. And this is being dismissed at the end of my service. And what is this? Ah, these are the letters that I wrote to the security officer in 93 and 94, asking if the Jew room policy, I didn't know it was called Jew room, but I knew rooms that were off limits to Jews, if that policy still existed. Okay, I was so upset with the fact that we knew and the Israelis didn't know that I began writing articles. It had to do with Jonathan Pollard. Jonathan Pollard was a Jew who worked for naval intelligence, and he saw that what he thought of as vital intelligence was not being passed to the Israelis. And this was in the mid-1980s. And he saw that his supervisors were anti-Semites and that they were withholding this, what he regarded as vital intelligence, from the Israelis. So he took it upon himself to pass the intelligence to the Israelis. So he violated his secrecy oath by becoming a spy against America? No, it wasn't against America, it was for Israel. But anyway, it was seen as him violating his secrecy oath. He was caught and sentenced to life imprisonment. And this bothered a lot of people in Israel. And at one demonstration on behalf of Jonathan Pollard outside the American consulate in Jerusalem, I happened to be there, and this was in the early 1990s. And Geula Cohen, a right-wing politician, very vocal, was lobbying on Jonathan Pollard's behalf. And she said, we can't rely on American intelligence. And she got off the stage, and I mentioned to her my story that Israel couldn't rely on intelligence that we had back in 1973. And she said, would you go up and take the microphone and just recount what you're telling me? And I did, and it was explosive. I was interviewed by newspapers and invited to television just to say that we knew in advance and somehow we didn't get the information to the Israelis. That's all that I knew. I didn't know at that time that we forwarded misinformation to the head of Israeli military intelligence. I didn't know that until about 5 years ago. So I began writing articles about Pollard. I saw him as an American hero, not just an Israeli or Jewish hero, but an American hero, that he stood in the wake of the Nuremberg judgments, that he was not going to engage in an act of inhumanity to man because Israeli civilians would suffer. And so he took it upon himself to pass, again, what he regarded as vital intelligence to an American ally, not an American enemy, yet he was given life imprisonment. In investigating the whole thing around the Yom Kippur War, I stumbled upon this article in the New York Times, September 12, 1975. I've got that implanted in my memory. that the Pike Commission, this was a congressional investigation commission to see if taxpayers' money was being well spent in intelligence gathering. One of the items that was mentioned during the investigation was the testimony of Dr. Ray Klein, who testified under oath, so help him God, that the American intelligence agencies were fooled in 1973. We didn't know. What? We did know. We did know. He's lying to the Congressional Investigation Committee. That's what got me ignited on probing. What's going on here? How could he lie? We knew. G6, that's the section in NSA that targets the Middle East. We knew. We knew definitively days in advance. And we knew on what day it was going to happen. How could he lie that we were fooled? This is a very interesting CIA intelligence summary talking about Syrian military placement on the Golan Heights and their staging for war. And what's interesting to me here is not the it's like a 5 or 6 page report. What's interesting to me here is, come on, little red, there it is, to state. You see that? Only to Ray Klein. Something smells. Why was it passed only to this Ray Klein? And it's so clear that he got this intelligence assessment that said clearly that the Syrians were staging for an attack on Israel, yet he lied to the Pike Commission. This is the intelligence board that Eli Zeira pointed out to me that he was in contact with. I don't know which of these generals or admirals he was in touch with, but one or two of them. This is the protocol of Moshe Dayan that was released after I got my manuscript approved by the Pentagon, stating what Eli Zeira confided in me, that he got an intelligence assessment from the Americans saying the Arabs were not going to attack. Precisely what Moshe Dayan says here. 12 hours before the attack actually began, he got an American intelligence assessment that the Arabs were not staging to an attack. Totally confirming what Eli Zeira confided in me. So I wanted to include this in my book, but I couldn't. It's new content. There were two other things that happened. One is that I got to interview a kashav, that's a radio monitor, an Israeli radio monitor that was monitoring the Syrians. And he said that there were three clear indications that the Syrians were going to attack the following day. And he sent this on to headquarters of Israeli intelligence. I wanted to include this in my book. And the third thing I wanted to include in my book brings us back to Texas. There was a man, a Texan, who joined the Army in 1971 and was in the Army till 1974, precisely the time that I was in, and he worked for USASA, United States Army Security Agency, in the field. And he was stationed in Germany in 1973 when there were some false alarms back in January, February, then in May again. But in October, he was repositioned with his unit from where he was stationed in Germany to a place, Italy, to be ready to collect intelligence from the war that was about to happen. He asked his supervisor, "We're passing this to our allies, the Israelis, aren't we?" And his supervisor said, "You have no need to know." In other words, the answer was negative. Then during the war, when they were collecting intelligence and they were passing it to us back in Fort Meade, Maryland at NSA, he asked his supervisor again, "At least we're sharing the intelligence that we're collecting now with our friends, the Israelis." And he got the same answer, "Not your job to ask." He was so bothered by this Texan, big, tall Texan, about as tall as you, Terry. He was so bothered by this that after he got out of the Army, honorable discharge, and he came back to Texas, he converted to Judaism and he made Aliyah. He immigrated to Israel. And about 4 years ago, maybe three and a half, his wife passed away, and he went up on a dating site to meet the new Mrs. And my sister was on this dating site. And I meet this tall Texan at my sister's apartment, and we get chatting with one another. And he tells me his story. And I said, "I have to include your story in my book." So now I have three items that I really want to put in my book, but I can't unless I go back to the Pentagon and get them to review and approve again. So this book has been approved by the Pentagon twice. This is when I went to my congressman in California, and this is his assistant, and that's where I got. Okay, the head of the Hebrew department was a very, very close friend. When I got married in Brooklyn, because the Israeli rabbanut wouldn't allow me to get married in Israel, because I couldn't prove that I was Jewish. They wanted a ketubah, a marriage certificate of my parents. And my parents had just moved to Florida about that time, and they couldn't find their marriage certificate. So in order to get married, we had to leave Israel. And here we are in Brooklyn, and who came up to hold a corner of the marriage canopy? My buddy. We called him Uncle Leo. That was his nickname. I can't give you his real name. He came up to hold a corner of my marriage canopy. I told you he's a genius of language. He became the head of the Arabic department subsequent. And after 9/11, he said, "Don't contact me anymore. I can't be in touch with you," which broke my heart because I loved the guy. We lived with him. After we got married, we moved in to Uncle Leo's home in Laurel, Maryland. And he rented out rooms to single military people who worked at NSA. And he called it, jokingly, he called it Uncle Leo's home for unwed fathers. So we moved into Uncle Leo's home for unwed fathers. And it breaks my heart that we had to give up contact with him. This is the result of the polygraph test. you'll have to take my word for it unless you speak Hebrew. You can see that I speak the truth. Who's this handsome guy? I don't know if you believe in God, but I had a God incident. When I was finishing writing my book, a neighbor of mine that I play music with, a single lady, I called her on her phone, and a guy answers the phone, and he says that he found this phone in Jerusalem. So I went to pick up the phone, her phone, and I asked this young man, not him, that's his father, I asked this young man who is in his probably late 30s, early 40s maybe, but anyway, he was born after the Yom Kippur War. So I was curious, a young Israeli, would you be interested in buying a book that discloses the truth behind the surprise of the Yom Kippur War? And he answered, no. I said, why such an answer like that? And he says, my father wrote a book precisely on that topic, and he's obsessed with it. And this is the book. And he takes me to his apartment and finds the book. And his father's life was threatened that he better not disseminate the book under threat of his life. And I felt that of the 9 million people, I know that that's not a big deal for you folks who live in the Dallas-Fort Worth metropolitan area, because that's the population of your area, of your metropolitan area. But in Israel, that's the entire population of the country. Of the 9 million people who live in Israel, I happen to get my hands on this book. It discloses what he believes is the secret behind the Yom Kippur War surprise. And I felt that since that book fell into my hands, one in a million would be a miracle, one in 9 million is a super miracle, that I felt it a divine mission to have this book translated into English, which I did, and edited, which I did, and it's going to be going up through Ingram Spark and Amazon. It's going up in the next week or two. So I call it the Kissinger connection. How appropriate that he just passed away yesterday. Maybe another God incidence. So keep your eyes open for the Kissinger connection, written by this man. This is the author in his younger days, Doron Hakimi. And this is him today. He's an 82-year-old man, and I believe that he's a speaker of truth. And this is what the front cover of his book will look like. And this is the cover of my book, and you can get it in the back. And this is the Hebrew version of my book. And that young man on the top impersonating me, wearing my American Army uniform of 52 years ago, that's my youngest son. And he today is wearing an Israeli Army uniform, and he's stationed on the Golan Heights with his Special Forces Army unit, heading off with the Hezbollah and the Syrians. Questions?
Before we ask the questions, there's one thing I know about your story that I'd like for you to share, and that is what Nixon did during the Yom Kippur War about resupplying and how the underlings were trying to, his lieutenants were trying to hold off on resupplying Israel and what he told them?
I'm not hearing you well.
Okay. How Nixon ordered his subordinates to resupply Israel. Can you tell them that story?
Right. Okay, the resupply of Israel. Israel was caught by surprise, and they weren't prepared for the Saga weapons. This was a anti-tank weapon that was kind of the new bazooka that the Egyptians used against the Israelis, and the Syrians used against the Israelis, and the Israelis lost maybe half of their tanks in the first week of the war, and they needed resupply desperately. And Caspar Weinberger and Henry Kissinger were dragging their feet on the resupply. Alexander Haig, in his book, Inner Circles, described an event that happened in the Oval Office where Caspar Weinberger and Henry Kissinger were there with Richard Nixon. And Richard Nixon asked, did the Israelis prepare their wish list? And Kissinger said, yes, I have it here in my pocket. Nixon said, double it and do it right away. Get out and do it right away. I'm not going to use the expletives that he
That's
used.
Okay. We get the point. Okay, questions, comments? There were some hands over here.
Well, I'm just curious about what the United States is doing today in Israel. Are they helping or hindering, or some of the same of what you were saying? I mean, are they really giving good advice to Israel?
Well, I told you my story about what happened 50 years ago. I also told you that I'm from Missouri as far as the Jew room, if it exists today, or maybe it exists under some other name. I don't know. I can only speak about what happened 50 years ago, but something smells today as well. Something smells, and there has to be an explanation. It took 50 years for Israelis barking up the wrong trees all the time over the past 50 years to find out how they were fooled on Yom Kippur 50 years ago. It had to wait for Bruce Brill to come out. So I hope it won't take another 50 years to find out what went wrong on October 7th.
To follow up on her question, it was such a shock and surprise. I can't help but think that either American intelligence or Israeli intelligence didn't know something.
Well, you know, the title of this book, Deceit of an Ally, is a little bit problematic. I went to the Nefesh B'Nefesh, that's soul against soul, or soul standing up with soul, and the OU, the Union of Orthodox Rabbis, to ask to give a book signing talk. And that's why I doubly appreciate Tom and the Allen City Public Library for giving me a venue here, because they wouldn't give me a venue. The head of the OU said, how can I give you a venue to speak about America being deceitful? And I said, I don't know about you, but I enlisted in the American Army for 4 years of my life. I enlisted for 4 years. In the end, it was only 3 years because they gave us a year early out. But I enlisted for 4 years. I don't know if you're more patriotic than me, but this is not an anti-American book. It may sound like it. If anything, it's anti-American. On the back cover, I even gave a subtitle, Un-American Deep State NSA Cabal Duped Israel in 73. Because there are good people in America, and I don't hate America, but I do hate un-American cabal within the intelligence community that work against America's allies. I don't know if that answers your question.
Okay, I have actually two questions, but I'll ask one, and if there's time, I'll pass on if there's not time for a second question. So the first question is, the USS Liberty that was sank or strafed or attacked in 1967, and the NSA was monitoring those, was there grudge?
Yes.
And that
yes.
played
yes.
into
yes.
1973.
Right. The what I learned only recently, in the past year, in reading about it, because it's of interest, at NSA, when I was there, the Israelis were called mad dog Israelis. And part of it stemmed from what happened in 1967, a half a dozen years before. What happened in 1967? The USS Liberty was spying on the Middle East. It was working for G6, for NSA. And Israel attacked it. And the question is, why did Israel attack the USS Liberty? Americans were killed and Americans were wounded. And the people who were wounded and the friends of people who were killed became middle management by 1973. And so here comes a Jew boy working in G6, and I think I might have been the only Jew boy working in G6. So understandably, in a way, understandably, I was under suspicion, perhaps. I mean, nobody said this out loud or overtly, but one thing that I discovered this past year, there were three planes that attacked the Liberty. Three planes. Two of them were flown by, are you sitting down? Two of them were flown by American Jews. So all the more reason that innocent me was under suspicion. Perhaps.
The other question I had was, the nature of privilege of information that spy agencies do, and that is that they don't always release information that they know so that the opponents don't know what the NSA knows. In other words, you can't always say what you know, because then your sources will be revealed. So for example, in World War II, the British were able to break the Enigma, but they weren't able to save everybody that the Enigma codes revealed that they were going to get attacked, because they didn't want the Nazis to know that Enigma had been cracked.
Right.
So did that play a part in 1973? That's the second question.
In what way?
So if the U.S. gave Israel the information in advance saying that they were going to be attacked in 1973, would that have blown the cover for the NSA's spy abilities?
Look, in 1983 already, there was a binational intelligence sharing agreement between Israel and America. But prior to 1983, there was an understood relationship between allies that you would necessarily share vital intelligence that an ally needed. American stated policy was friendly to Israel. I talk about that in my book. I give all kinds of examples and proofs. I mean, it was a duh question that America and Israel are like that. Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. And the American Jews are faithful and patriotic. For example, in World War II, Jews volunteered and served in the American army at a higher percentage than any other ethnic group. Jews are very patriotic. So of course America would share vital information with a stated American ally. Even prior to the 1983 intelligence sharing agreement, even prior.
Why is it that you're thinking that they did not share the information that they had? Oh, sorry. Are you thinking that it was anti-Semitism that led them to not share the information, to actually even withhold it? Or was it an economic issue? You know, people in power making money off Arab oil or whatever the situation was?
Okay. That's a good question. If I understood the question, and I'm not hearing very carefully, was the anti-Israel shenanigans because America wants to befriend oil-producing countries that are in Arab hands? I think that's part of it, but I think that good old-fashioned Jew hatred is also part of it. Look, my immediate supervisor at NSA, he was a Jew hater, and he had nothing to gain from Arab petroleum wealth. He just hated Jews, just plain and simple. For instance, there's a suburb of Baltimore, Pikesville, where there's a large percentage of Jews that live in Pikesville. Before he realized that I was a Jew, he would refer to it as Kikesville. You know, it had nothing to do with petroleum in his case. And I imagine that folks in the Jew room also were just simple, good old-fashioned Jew haters. I imagine, but I don't know. I never was part of the Jew room.
Questions, comments, protests? Questions? Okay, right here.
Hi, yeah, thank you for the presentation. It was pretty informative. To further elaborate on the lady's question, do you have any evidence, more than anecdotal evidence, that the agenda for U.S. passing on bad information to Israel was because of good old-fashioned Jew hatred? And do you think this act of passing bad information from U.S. to Israel was initiated at the top brass of NSA, or did it go further up in the chain of command?
Oh, well, again, I don't know the answer to that question. I would assume that Jew hatred is a disease that affects the little guy and the big guy. Why not? I mean, you see that through history. Adolf Hitler was the leader of Germany, and he hated Jews. And the average German, maybe also many of them, had a problem with Jews. How would I know?
And did you think it was a disease at the top of the chain of command, or was it like in the middle?
I'm sorry, I'm not hearing you.
He wants to know if it was higher, if the anti-Semitism existed higher than the National Security Agency.
Today or yesterday?
We're saying 73.
I can't answer that question. I don't know. But I think that the fact that there can be rooms within the agency that are secret within the agency and they're unmonitorable. Maybe President Nixon at the time didn't know anything about the Jew room and their shenanigans. It could be. I don't know. Look, Richard Nixon came through to help and assist Israel at a critical moment.
Questions, comments, protests?
Hi, can you hear me? Yeah, hello. I don't know if this is relevant or not, or if Yuri can even answer this, but were the Egyptian army, were they just very well equipped with the latest in Soviet gear, and were they trained by the Soviet advisors and all that stuff? Because their tactics and everything. Did you hear that?
No.
He wanted to know if in 73 the Egyptian army had superiority in training versus the Israeli army. Is that correct? And they were how they were equipped from the Soviet Union.
They were not only equipped by the Soviet Union, they were given very sophisticated weaponry, and they were given huge quantities of it. And Kissinger and the State Department turned a blind eye to it, and they should have been blowing the whistle and keeping the Soviets from engaging in resupplying and supplying the Arabs with all this quantity and quality of weaponry. Not only that, but pilots, the Soviets brought planes, MiGs, the latest MiGs, that they refused to let Egyptian pilots fly because they weren't trained. So who flew these MiGs? Soviet pilots. Soviet pilots. And in this book, in Hakimi's book, he documents that Soviets were caught and became Israeli prisoners of war that were there on the battlefront, advising and engaging in the use of Soviet sophisticated weaponry.
One last question, okay?
Thanks for the talk. I've always heard that Mossad is such a premier spy agency, the Israeli, Mossad. And how did they get caught with their pants down both back on October 6th and again this time on October 7th? Where were they?
Well, you'll have to buy my book.
Okay.
What happened was basically that they weren't caught with their pants down. Amman, Israel military intelligence was not. But there was a bottleneck between Amman, Israeli military intelligence, and the cabinet, the decision makers. There was one man that served as the bottleneck, and that man was General Eli Zeira. And instead of relying on his own intelligence services, which were spot on, he relied instead on the American intelligence assessment that he received. I want to give you an example of the fact that he was smart in doing that, smart and stupid at the same time. Why smart? When I worked in NSA in 1973-74, I saw satellite photographs of an Israeli army base in the Sinai, and I could read the name of the Israeli soldier off of his kippah. That's how accurate and amazing our resources were. And our satellites could peruse the entire Sinai. At the same time, a man named Shabtai Brill, same last name as mine, he contacted me because this is back in the days when there were telephone books. I wrote my last name Brill, Beit Resh Yud Gershayim Lamed, which, what does that mean? It means that I wrote my name as an acronym, which it is. It's a Hebrew acronym. I won't go into a family roots discussion, but he contacted me to ask me about our common family name. It turns out that he was a pioneer in drone flights for intelligence surveillance in the late 1960s and early 1970s. And he would take, you're sitting down, American toy planes that were remotely controlled, and he affixed cameras to these planes, and he would send them over the Suez Canal. And how far could they travel? A couple hundred yards, and photograph some Egyptian military installations. Compare that to what the Americans were capable of doing. So of course he relied on the American assessment that he got over his own intelligence assessment. Because American resources, and if you just look at the numbers, how much money is spent in American intelligence as opposed to how much is spent in Israeli military intelligence, American is not double, or triple, or quadruple, or 10 times, or 50 times. Do the arithmetic. 80 times more resources in American intelligence. So of course, Eli Zeira is not stupid. The opposite of stupid. He relied on American intelligence assessments that he received. But he didn't know that they were false. And he was the bottleneck between the intelligence community and the cabinet.
Bruce Brill, thank you. Come buy a book in the back. Hurry back.